Right before we jump into this video, if you'd like to take better pictures in only 11 days, I created a free mini video course that you can sign up for right now at froknowsphoto.com/11days. Jared Poland, froknowsphoto.com, and this is a real world review of the autofocus from the Nikon Z6 II. Now, what makes it real world? Well, on Sunday morning at 8 a.m., I went out to the football field where Coach Abe was training some quarterbacks, and that is a great subject to try the lock-on tracking, the IAF, that little box that puts a red square around a certain area so you can tell the autofocus where it needs to be. That's what I did. I took it out with the 70-200 2.8, the 1.4 converter, the 2X converter, the 14-24 2.8, which is fantastic, by the way. It's right here. I'm in love with this lens, as well as the new battery grip right here. I also recorded my electronic viewfinder so that you could see the focusing points moving. You could see when I was taking pictures. You could see my settings. You could see my angles. That's the greatest thing about the Nikons, is that it allows you, with high quality, much better than what Sony lets us do, record the EVF. And it doesn't affect the focusing speeds. We've tested it both ways, with and without. It works the same, and it's just the best way that you can see it in action. You'll also be able to download sample RAW files, and yes, I can open the RAW files and convert them into DNGs so that I can edit them in Lightroom, but what you're gonna see right now are a bunch of clips all lined up together showing you different autofocuses and me out there shooting the football training. We'll be right back. So it doesn't get any more real world than that, than showing you exactly what I was shooting. But the real determining factors here is, how did it do? And I will tell you, we're gonna look at the images in just a second. I think it did better than I expected it to do. Now, a lot of people are going to ask, how does it compare to the Z6? Well, I didn't take the Z6 into this exact situation at the same time to be able to compare them side by side. Is there a night and day difference? The answer is no. But it worked fairly well out there in this real world situation. I will tell you that I did fight with the autofocusing system from time to time because it just doesn't work the same ways that the Sony and the Canons do. Those seem to be a little bit more advanced, but looking here at the images, it doesn't seem like I really missed a lot of the time. Now, I loved the 70-200. The feel of that lens is tremendous. And this image is perfectly sharp. So something people ask me a lot about is, how was the hit rate? Well, I can't tell you the hit rate because it's going to be different in every situation. It's going to be different in each photographer's hands. What lenses were you using? What were your settings? Was it bright? Was it dark? Was there a lot of contrast? So when people talk about hit rate, just understand it's different in every situation. I will tell you, in this situation, it hit a ton of the time. It didn't miss that much. But with that being said, what I will tell you is, once you acquire the focus, once you can get the camera to go where it needs to go, it will hit time and time again. It's that in-between time where you're like, pick the camera up and you're like, okay, focus, will you get to where you need to be, where you might miss shots. Unlike with the Sony, which is super snappy. I took out the A7C with a new 70-300 Tamron kit lens, and when I pick the camera up and you tap the shutter button, it just acquires like that. When Nikon can get to that, you might find me switching back when they have a pro body that can move the focusing points quickly, economically, instantly. You might find me shooting with more Nikons. Now, moving on to this image, this is with the 14-24 at 14 millimeters. Look how straight those lines are. Look at the awesome color at 8:30 in the morning. That is fantastic. But I was in the wide area AF for people mode, which just really, it just bounces around all over the place because it doesn't know where to look. First, it found the kid on the right. But I'm like, what if I want Abe in focus back here because he's coaching? That is where this camera lacks. It's a little slower. And then when I have to hit the one of the function buttons to activate subject tracking, it's so slow and antiquated. I have to hit the function button, it pulls up this box, I've got to arrow it over to where I want it to be, and it skips and moves slowly, and it's a big box. And then I hold my finger halfway down, and then it stays sort of locked onto that subject. Now, with the Sonys and with the Canons, you always have an active autofocusing point to start with, or something that you can, I call it, juice the system, or just tell it where you want it to be. For example, I picked up the A7C and it was right in the middle. I'm like, okay, I found the subject, I locked it, and I just moved, and now it's gonna be locked on the whole time. Where with the Nikon, you just have to go through such an antiquated system that it's much slower. When that gets better and it's fully active all the freaking time, it's going to be great. Now, back to this image, I could use that new wide area box and put that on Coach Abe, but what happens when I want to switch out of it and get the other subject? I now have to move that box. It's just, it's slow. It's just, it. You really shouldn't need all of these different options that you need to switch back and forth on to get the shot. Let me jump in here real quick and say, would you like me to send you this free guide to capturing motion in low light situations? Well, if so, just look for this orange box over on the website, put your name, email address in it, hit send it, and I will send you that guide for free. This I just loved at 24 millimeters. Super close. The autofocus, you don't even know it's moving. With the 14-24 and with the 70-200, you can't even tell. It's so fast. In fact, I think it's faster than the Sony lenses, and it may be on par with the Canon. That stuff is hard to say. But I will tell you, I will take Nikon professional glass any day of the week over Sony G Master lenses. I just feel that they are designed better. I feel that they feel better in the hands. The zoom rings just work better. I just love these 2.8s, and they are super fast, contrary to what Sony tells you every time they have a press event. They tell you how everybody else's motors aren't good. I will tell you that the Nikons are blazingly fast with this Pro Glass. And I've beat up the 50 1.8 and the 85 1.8 for being not pro. I still hold told that they aren't the pros. When the 1.4s come out, when the 1.2s come out, you are gonna see a difference, a major difference. That's why I'm harsh on the 1.8s, because the 1.4s and the 1.2s are gonna be so much better. Now, this is where I switched to that box to move around Coach Abe's face. We saw that it found the kid when I switched over to him, but it had trouble with the mask. We've noticed that if you have a mask on, it won't find you. Also, with darker skinned individuals, it has trouble picking up the eyes. And that's just something where you can see it in the video. You can see that it finds the kid, but it has more trouble with Coach Abe trying to find his eyes in that situation. I just find that box is not really useful. I know a lot of people talk about wanting to use it for weddings because maybe it will stop you from missing the people coming down the aisle. I will tell you, with the Sonys and with the Canons, you don't miss. And if you ever have an issue, you have an active focusing point at all times. Next up, this is one done with a 1.4 converter. And I zoom in here, I'm not sure that it's tack sharp on the eye in this case. It's a good photo. Look how the background just blows out. You can see that you go to F4, and I'm still at 1/3200th of a second, but I wanted to find the eye better. Now, this one is with the same 1.4 converter. It looks really good. The colors, the tones, the focusing, I didn't notice that I was losing any focusing speed, but I will tell you, with the 2x converter, now we're out at 400 millimeters, you just have to be careful. I bumped up to 400 ISO because I knew I was going to 5.6, and then 1/2000th of a second. When we zoom in here, it's not super duper tack sharp on the eye, and I know a lot of people love and swear by teleconverters. I hate teleconverters. Now, these teleconverters work really well on the Nikon. I've just never been a fan because it's always taken away quality. Now, of course, you have to decide that if you're shooting nature type things and wildlife, do you want to crop or do you want to break out that 2x converter? And for the most part, the 2x converter is going to be fine. It's just, in my opinion, it's not as tack sharp as if you just had a 400 millimeter lens. It's also not going to be as expensive as having a 400 millimeter lens. Moving on to the next one, this one's at 20.5 millimeters. This, where you saw the video, the box was just bouncing all the way around. Now, here's an example of little Dan with I believe it's the R6 or the R5, but you can see that it's just tracking his eye. Even when he backs up underneath a tree in the shade, it finds his eye. As he comes towards me, the eye is still in focus, or it switches to the face when it's super far away. That's what I wanna see the Nikon do. I wanna see it be active all the time, because I always wanna shoot with the Nikon right now in that mode where it's the IAF and the fully active autofocusing points, so that the camera can find the face when it can, and find the eye when it can, and then I can take the pictures. But these examples that you see right now on the screen of the football player running, shooting with adapted lenses on the Canon, you can see that it nails the face, and you can see that the overlay keeps up with the subject, unlike with the Nikon. That's what I'm talking about. The Canons do a fantastic job. The Sonys do a fantastic job. The Nikons, the overlay is slow and laggy. It's hitting the focus, as you'll see in these pictures that are about to come up, but I just want to see the system tweaked. I want to see it get better and better. Nikon is doing okay. It's usable. I mean, I'm very happy with the results I got. I mean, look at this. 14 millimeters, got down low, got the quarterback guy right here warming up. I just love this shot. The light on him is fantastic. Moving on to the next image, I laid flat on the ground to get this. This is the unedited version, but I want to show you some of the presets from FroPak 1 and FroPak 2, starting with, we've got Ovaltine right here. Now, that's a one-click edit. Now, this is a starting point, but check it out. We've got Harvest Moon Vibrant. This one looks pretty cool. Then we've got Universal Soldier, which is a really good catch-all, a great starting point. AC/DC is nice and vibrant. We've got Sandlot to give you this old school look. And finally, Skittles. Now, like I said, this is just a starting point because we could brighten this up. Like, all right, exposure, We could pull back on some of this vibrance, but with one click, it gave us a great starting point, and then you can tweak from there. Now, if you didn't know, we created 15 all-new custom Lightroom presets that you can check out right now at froknowsphoto.com/fropack2. While you're over there, you can play with the sliders to see the befores and the afters, and if you decide that they're for you, you can pick them up on sale right now, or you can pick up the bundle and save even more. Now, let's jump back in to these images. Now we're gonna get into the sequence of shots. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They're all in. The sixth one is out. The seventh one is out, but that's okay. You're gonna miss every once in a while. Like I said, I fought with the focusing system from time to time. In this situation, it did okay. It missed those two, but in the next one, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 as he's coming back, and it nailed each one of those. Now, I wasn't in the high plus mode for that. Remember, that drops you down to 12-bit RAW. I was shooting at 14-bit RAW. I did shoot some at 12 plus. The one of the football player, the quarterback where I laid down on the ground, that one was done with the high plus. In this case, it tracked very well as I shot. You saw 10 shots in a row. It nailed it without an issue. Now, if subjects were going to get in the way, that's where this autofocusing system could have some issues, because you don't have an active focusing point to go ahead and tell it where it needs to be if it ever misses. All right, so let's get to the next one. This is really good. I just left the 70-200 on for most of the day without the converter because I could go wherever I needed to go. This is super tack sharp. Love the colors of the files. Give me the colors and the files of Nikon any day of the week over Canon, over Sony, over everybody else, except I've actually heard that Pentax colors are pretty good. I really need to get one of those Pentaxes and use it because their colors actually are really good. But look at this, top to bottom. Being able to get the focus, it's nailed. Love that shot. Next, this quarterback right here, we've got another nice shot, super tack focused and sharp right on him. And then to wrap it up, he threw this ball, then he started running this way where the focus did acquire him. And then in the last one, I know it acquired his face. So overall, it did a very good job. But when I talk about the focus being sticky on a subject, especially if somebody runs in the way, the Canon we know can do it. The Sony we know can do it. The Nikons, it's on the edge. It will miss every once in a while. All these cameras are gonna miss every once in a while. Am I surprised with how well it did? Yeah, I'm pretty surprised that it did fairly well in the situation I was using it in with the settings I had on. But I will tell you, I did fight the autofocus. I did want to use lock-on tracking or subject tracking more often, but it was impossible to reach that button all the time and then move the focusing point. It just should be active all the time. If Nikon can make those corrections, if they can come out with a pro body that can match what the Sony and what the Canon are doing, at least with the overlay, to make that feel, make you mentally feel more confident with your work, then I think they're going to be onto something. They are on the right path. Now look, if you're shooting landscapes, this autofocus stuff doesn't really matter for you. Give me Nikon all day of the week for landscapes. I love the glass, I love the colors, I love the tones. Now, a few things to wrap this up. I did see some comments where people were like, IAF is a gimmick, and I do really well with toggle focus, which is slowly moving focusing points. Now, those are statements that people make that are either afraid to change and afraid to evolve, and they're going to be left behind. It's like those photographers who shot film but were afraid to go digital. They're like, oh, I can't do that. We have this technology. If you have the technology at your fingertips, you're going to use it. It's like saying, why don't you sell your car and get a horse, because that's what people used to do. Or more in the photo terms, why don't you shoot manual focus even though you have autofocus? It's the same thing. We have this technology, utilize it. Don't sit there and poo-poo it, because you're gonna be left behind. So don't forget, you can download sample RAW files and see them for yourselves. This is just one test. I know I went a little more in detail here because I'm a Nikon lover. I love Nikon. I shot Nikon since I was 15. If they can give me what I want, I will be back to using Nikon as my stills body. I will tell you that because I've already said I love a lot of what's going on with these systems, or more so with the glass and with the colors. Everything else hopefully will follow suit. So let me know what you guys think. We're gonna spend a lot more time doing other tests with these cameras, and we'll bring out those videos as they happen. Thank you very much for watching. Jared Poland, FroKnowsPhoto.com. See ya.